coverage by concerning agencies. I think we need to have mechanisms for collaboration at multiple level, and this is one of the example which I saw and recently. This is a simple neonatal transport ambulance which has been designed by scientists from IIT Chennai. And as I know, this ambulance has been used in more than 100 this kind of ambulances have been used by Tamil Nadu state for transport of critically ill newborns. And I feel that this kind of models need to be worked with collaboration with this technical organizations. I feel as a society, we need to grow, we need to mature, and we need to sustain. The number of centers have increased from 14 to 90 over the period of 20 years. The specialists are growing. At the same time, we need to respect all the branches equally. When we work as a multidisciplinary unit as a pediatric cardiac care, I feel there need to be a shift from paternalism to the partnerships. Some of the practices were of past. We need to work for a better society to look ahead. Need to develop a self-auditing mechanism when all the partners come together as team members. And this is one of the chart which has been highlighted by one of our past president, how the pediatric heart program need to be going ahead. All the specialties and all the partners who are involved in the so-called pediatric cardiac care or pediatric heart program need to be respected and rewarded equally. The team approach is the practice of pediatric cardiac care, and all the members who are involved in the teams and the specialties have to work with harmony with each other. The interdisciplinary collaboration is the crux when we are taking care of the newborns and small babies with heart defects and getting the outcomes successfully. For this, we need to strengthen the ICUs when we are having increasing numbers of neonates and infants coming for a pediatric cardiac care. We have to recognize and reward the paramedical support, especially the cardiac ICU nursing. And maybe we'll have to incorporate simple measures to improve the outcomes, like establish cohesive teams, quality improvement initiatives, and innovative techniques. When we try to consolidate gains over the period of time, I think there are some key requirements for a successful program. The skill of the team members is utmost important. We need to build up the mechanism to communicate and have a collective decisions. Maybe whenever multiple teams and multiple specialties come together, the disagreements are inevitable, but we need to develop a mechanism for dealing with disagreements. And at some time, the leader is the most important person who keeps all these paramedics and medicos together, and their roles need to be very well defined. We may have barriers for developing this program, programs running successfully, maybe egos, we don't have times for individual, and sometimes a traditional hierarchy also can become a problem. When we look at it, sometimes I feel there needs to be some shift of the service. I know that clinical excellence is the summit, but the clinical expertise need to go to the base to make this pyramid very strong. And at the same time, there need to be a change of the leaderships of running the programs. We know both these giants and both these concepts are very good and very important, but over the period of time, I think the fixed space need to shift to a flexible space, and it's a need of time when we try to go ahead. The honest differences when we work together, of the honest differences of views and debates are not disunity, they are just a vital process of policy making among free men. And the role of a leader is to be keep all the tweaks together, and nothing should be falling apart. We know autonomy comes with greater responsibilities, otherwise we become the same against whom we rebelled. These are some of the concerns of my past president, and I'm very happy to say that over the period of 2 years, we managed to start the fellowship in pediatric electrophysiology, fetal cardiology, and pediatric cardiac intensive care fellowships. I know it's a very beginning and a long way to go, but at least we started, and I hope with more and more students coming for these fellowships over the period of years, we will strengthen these subspecialties in pediatric cardiology as well. As an organization, we have realized reforms are very inevitable. We are more inclusive over the period of last few years. We are giving voices to our unsung heroes in our success stories, and they are mainly the ICU care experts, anesthetists, nursing, perfusion professionals. And we have now added even the physician assistant in our group, and we are expanding as a society to give them memberships. But one of the questions we were discussing in this conference, can we address all children with congenital heart defects? In the map of India, half of the states of India doesn't have even a primary cardiac care. And as a society, it's our responsibility to get them, all these children under the so-called umbrella of pediatric cardiac care. Average child in India needs access to comprehensive cardiac services, maybe a distant dream, but I think it's a worthwhile goal for all of us to pursue. Thank you very much for bestowing on me the greatest honor of our professional life. With the leadership of our incoming president, Dr. Rajesh Sharma, I'm sure the society will reach newer heights. Thank you, everybody. And it's my honor to hand over this leadership to Dr. Rajesh Sharma.
Over to Dr. Iyer, sir, for comments. And no questions are allowed as a presidential oration. So,
Rajesh Sharma, as incoming president, to give the final concluding comments and show us the way forward for the coming year.
Thank you for those words, Dr. Snehal, and thank you, Dr. Iyer. This is a big honor, and it's extremely humbling to be given this responsibility of leading the organization, which has been led so ably in the past 2 years by Dr. Snehal through our tough times, and to my left by Dr. Iyer, Dr. Suresh in the past. And I hope that I can do justice to it. I will do my very best. Going forwards, I have some thoughts in my head, which we will collectively brainstorm and see how we can take it forwards beyond where Dr. Snehal has left us. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Now I request Dr. Iyer to present a memento to our president now. Now I would request Snehal ma'am to pass on the President Medal to Dr. Rajesh Sharma, sir. Thank you, everyone. We now go to the other important function of the day, which is the... So may I now call upon the chairperson for the event, Professor S.C. Manchanda, sir, Dr. Srinath Reddy, Dr. Balram Bhargav, Dr. K.C. Goswami, and Dr. Rajiv Narang to the dais. I would request Dr. Rajiv Narang, sir, to accompany Dr. Kotari, sir. So we have made a small, short introduction by about Dr. Rajan Tandon by one of his most beloved student, Dr. Krishna Kumar. Can we have those videos?
My dear friends and colleagues, I consider this as the singular greatest honor to be chosen to provide the introduction for the Raj Tandon Memorial Lecture. Professor Tandon was my mentor and in many ways a father figure in my life. And I'm sure that was the same relationship with so many others. Dr. Tandon was born in 1931, and this is a picture from his early childhood. He spent his initial years at KJMC in Lucknow, where he graduated from, and then went on to the US for his advanced training at the Mass General Hospital in Boston. That was followed by a training under the legendary Professor Alexander Nadas at the Children's Hospital Boston in the early 60s. He was admired by his friends, colleagues, and he left a tremendous legacy there. This is from one of his colleagues, Francis Nakamura, who truly admired him for the fact that he was so committed to coming back to India, which he did. And he helped the development of the cardiology department at All India Institute. He did have another visit to the United States. In his second innings, he spent time with Professor Jesse Edwards, the renowned cardiac pathologist, and they have done some remarkable path-breaking work together in a number of congenital heart lesions, where they have outlined the pathology of all the individual conditions. Much of what they have done are foundations for our understanding even today. Dr. Tandon was a legendary clinician with remarkable clinical acumen. His diagnostic skills at the bedside were legendary. This book captures a number of his axioms and is incredibly popular. The proceeds of this book have been donated to the PCSI. Dr. Tandon was very much loved by his family, but I think his definition of family extended much more beyond the biological family, and he adopted so many of us as his professional sons and guided and mentored us many years after his retirement.